Is your church looking to grow? Is your church stuck in the same position year after year? Is your church struggling post-COVID? Well, in this video, I'm going to share three ways your church can kickstart growth. Well, hey there, and welcome to a new video. This video was originally written as a blog, and you can read that blog by becoming a blog subscriber for only 99p per month. New blogs drop every week. Just go to www.thinking.church/blog to find out more. Also, don't forget to like this video, subscribe, and hit that bell icon to get our latest videos on your feeds. Alrighty then, church growth is a divisive phrase. For some, the word is exciting. A church that is growing has a buzz, more people coming to know Jesus, fuller auditoriums, more leaders. For others, this phrase talks about turning church into a corporation. It's all about getting numbers for numbers' sake, organizational growth without spiritual growth, and looking like the next big thing. At Thinking Church, we don't focus on growth, we focus on health. Why is that? Well, think like a parent. Are you more focused on your children growing or being healthy? Being unhealthy can stunt a person's growth. However, when you are healthy, growth just happens. To stretch this further, think about when a person stops growing. The reason you stop growing is because it will become unhealthy to grow much further. A quick Google of gigantism shows that it is very possible to grow beyond the point of health. And when that happens, life expectancy goes down. Think about churches that plant multiple locations, also known as multi-sites. If you're not healthy to start with, you start replicating ill health and the whole church can suffer as a result. Common symptoms of this are launching too soon, launching with a different culture, launching in the wrong location, launching too many. It's growth, but it's not good growth, often not sustainable growth. Would this then suggest that there's an ideal maximum size of a church? Well, that would be missing the point. It's not about maximum size, it's about health. As long as you stay healthy, growth is fine. In the UK, we rarely have the problem of gigantism. Our problem is dwarfism. Most churches are reaching fewer people than they could. And the common cause, you guessed it, health. What churches need is health. So what does health look like? It starts with clarity of mission, values, and strategy. And one of those strategies is growth. How do you reach more people? So what are the things that are going to help you reach more people? It depends on your context, your target market, and the skills and abilities within your church. But here's a few that you should start thinking about. The statistics are clear. Most people who engage with the church in person have been engaging for a long time online. It's the modern world. When was the last time you went to a restaurant and didn't check out the menu online first? Engagement happens well before people step in the building. Here's the issue. It puts a lot of pressure on your service. Suddenly, less than excellent worship is non-negotiable. Would you listen to someone sing out of tune on your computer? No way. Would you listen to a 30-minute talk if it didn't grab you in the first 10 seconds? No way. The counter argument to this is that we shouldn't be catering to consumers, but to those who really want to engage. It's a nice thought, but the simple fact is that everyone starts off as a consumer. The point is that you take people on a journey from consumer to fully devoted follower of Christ. If you want to reach people, you need to meet people where they're at. An excellent weekend service is now a given if you want to reach more people. Excellence is a baseline, but so too is authenticity. You can create an excellent service, great music and great preaching, but if there's no authenticity to who you are, your online audience will be in for a shock when they arrive in person. Don't throw out authenticity for the sake of excellence, and vice versa. Both must exist. Of course, in the post-COVID world, online services are no longer an option. They're a necessity. Like with church online, engagement happens online far before physically entering the building. So it's worth thinking about your website. Who does it exist for? What does it exist to do? Throughout the brief history of the internet, websites have gone through a number of phases regarding their existence. The early purpose of the website was to make it a notice sign. That is, to just create an online presence that you exist. The next iteration of the website was all about forums, creating places for people to chat was the next big thing. But with the real problem that there was no real purpose behind this conversation, not to mention the amount of time it took to curate the content. The next phase of the website became making websites a news source, websites like the BBC popularized websites as a place that you could come back to. So there was a need for regular news and posts. The latest iteration of websites is to blend the three into a purposeful sales website. It's no longer just about creating an online presence, it's about creating a funnel to help people take next steps. It's not just about community, it's about finding the right community experience for the right purpose. It's not just about news, it's about meaningful content that helps you stay top of mind for those you're seeking to reach. So with your church website, think about creating it for first-time guests. What do they need to know? What do they not need to know? What community space do they need? What content would be right for them? After you've sorted that, you can begin to strategize about how you lay out your website. Here, it's worth reading up on the best of practice of where to place buttons and how to write copy. If you want to reach more people, everything about your website should be intentional. If you're a multi-site church or thinking about going multi-site, this should be your number one strategy. However, we mostly find that very little strategy actually goes into the planting of new churches or campuses. Many plants happen on an opportunity basis. A church folding hands over the keys to the building, or someone moves up to another location and offers to set up a new campus, or often you pick a big city and hope for the best. Before you plant, you have to know why you want to plant. If your reasoning is that you've promised to plant a defined number of campuses, or that you think it will make your church look bigger than it actually is, stop. The world doesn't need any more vanity campuses. Only plant from a place of health. There's a number of strategies around the best way to plant, but the majority comes down to this. Do you have a nationwide or worldwide brand? If you're known throughout the country, the options for planting new campuses or churches become a lot more open. Here's the obvious problem though. That's really hard to get, unless you're a Hillsong, Bethel, or Elevation, or whatever. If you have this, you can rock up at almost any location and it will draw people because your brand has gone before you, so people know what to expect. Remember, your brand is your reputation. When people know who you are and what to expect, you can go to places that you haven't been before and you'll draw people. If you don't have a nationwide brand, there is still hope. The best place is to start with the congregation you've got. Look for pockets of congregation that are traveling from 20 to 30 minutes away. Then look to start a campus there. Be careful though, there's a reason that they're traveling 20 to 30 minutes to get to your church. You need to make sure you replicate the same feel, heart, and excellence in your new campus. Don't forget, these are not exclusive routes for growth, and doing them doesn't guarantee you'll reach more people. At the end of the day, Christ will build his church. We have the awesome responsibility, like Paul and Apollos, of planting seeds and watering them. But in the end, only Jesus makes them grow. What may work for you may not work for others. Well, that's all for today. I'll see you next time.